Well, usually intubation and suction are done by nurse assistants and nurses, but, and therefore you may think that it's nothing for the doctors. But actually, most of the studies that I refer to are done by my friends here in the faculty, so it may be important. And especially, you can actually have severe problems in some patients if you don't think about it. So I start with humidification, but as I told you, I need to do some humidification myself. Okay, so regarding humidification, why should you do it, how should you do it, when should you do it, and why? Of course, when you bypass your normal humidification system, the nose, then you get thickened mucus, reducing mucociliary transport, the reduced cilia beatings, and the mucosa cell damage leading to apoptosis, necrosis, and this of course may develop lung collapse and ultimately pneumonia. And even also thinking about small children, you lose a lot of water energy by breathing, and if you don't replace that, then you can lose a lot of temperature, up to 1 degrees per hour in these children. And the normal acceptable and acceptable humidity, about 35 milligram we have up here in trachea when I'm breathing at 32 degrees, and then it goes up to 44 milligram per liter where down in the lungs, and it says about 30 milligram is acceptable. Otherwise you get the problem. During non-invasive ventilation that has been shown by Laurent's group, that when the airways are, upper airways are not bypassed, you don't need to have so much humidification. So how do we do it? We have the heat moisture exchangers, we have the active humidifiers, and we have the hybrids. And the heat moisture exchangers, you have this with when you breathe out, during exhalation, the water is trapped or absorbed by some filter, and then when you inhale again, the water is released back to the lungs. And we have two types of trapping devices. You have hygroscopic, the salt that traps the water, the most common, maybe the most effective, and then they have the hydrophobic, the folded paper, the PAL filter, maybe not so effective, but may be better for infection. So the plus is easy to use. They are inexpensive. But one thing, we talked about ventilator-induced lung injury. You have increased dead space in these filters, maybe up to 100 milliliters, not usually, but if it's, say, 100 milliliters, then in a breathing rate maybe 20, then that will be 2 liters in alveolar ventilation just to ventilate the filter or the HME. So you, I mean that if you have patients that you would like to reduce the tidal volumes and pressures, you should not use them. They take some time to work well because it needs to absorb the water. It takes about half an hour before they're working, so you have lesser time to ventilate the patient, you should not use them. And of course, large tidal volumes, then they will not absorb all the water. And if it leaks, of course, the water will comes out besides the tube, and that will may not come back to the patient. It can induce PEEP, especially if you try to inhale with different inhale agents that put this device between the endotracheal tube and the inhalation device between the endotracheal tube and the HME. Then you absorb a lot of this stuff in the HME, and you get a PEEP effect. It may be plugged by secretions, and all this can increase the work of breathing together with the increased dead space, and in some patients also increase the PSCO2. Here is the plug tube. Active humidifiers, you have two types. And first one, ultrasound is not used so much, and then we have the heated humidifier. Ultrasound, I have a reservoir that drips water on the oscillating membrane, and then you get the aerosol droplets. It's most used for inhalation, but still it's used for humidification. The other one is a heated humidifier, like Fisher-Pascal, that you have bubbling the air via a water container, and then you get very good humidity when you're in this exhalation part. You can keep a high humidification. Actually, it could be too good. It may induce over humidity, in particularly when a patient that is hypothermic, but the HMEs are not good in this type of patient. But you can consider that if you give too high temperature in this patient, then it will be free water. I've seen drowned ventilator, but it's usually the old ventilators, and we have wrong errors in volume measurements. I've seen the drowning of filters and expiratory tubing, and they are quite expensive. So then we'll have the hybrids. I used this, studied this for about 10 years, 12 years ago. It's an HME, and then you can deliver water here to get a good humidity even when you start the device, and it is good all the time, but it has not been used much, but still are doing develop new ones. This is a new one. I saw this in respiratory care by Pelosi and company that has the hydrovent gold. So it's still developed. I will not discuss about the hybrids. So what should you use? And what are you using? Are most of you using HMEs or active humidifiers? Does it matter? Here's a meta-analysis from critical care medicine. Regarding ventilator-associated pneumonia, no, it doesn't matter, it's the same. Mortality, it doesn't matter. And the same thing from the Cochrane library. There was no overall effect on the artificial airway occlusion, mortality, pneumonia, or respiratory complications. However, PRC to a minute ventilation were increased when HMEs was used. And the same, the cost of HME was lower. So, what can I say about this, and what do I use? I think that you should use heated humidifiers in ARDS patients, just due to the increased dead space of the device. Dubious secretions, and maybe also if you have COPD patients and breathing spontaneously. In all other conditions, I think that you can use HMEs. So I come to the second part of the talk, and that is about suctioning. The same thing, when, how, and how to avoid and treat side effects. Suctioning has been, at least in Sweden and the Scandinavian countries, done as a routine, and still is done that in 10% of the ICUs. And that should never be done, because it is have severe side effects. You should only do it when there are secretions in trachea, and you can see it cause crackles, and maybe you can see it increased inspiratory pressure during volume control, decreased tidal volumes during pressure control. But then you should consider that may be a change in chest wall compliance and in lung compliance that causes this. And the same thing in deteriorating oxygenation, it can be that you have lung collapse instead of mucus plugging. And in that case, you can cause problem by suctioning. Of course, you do it with secretions and suspected aspiration. And how? How many are you using open system? No one? Closed system, all the others? Yes. Open system is just when you remove the tube, remove the nipple, and then put in the catheter. And the closed system is this device, and you have a suction catheter here that you can move down in a tube, and then it's connected to the ventilator here. So you don't remove the ventilation during the suctioning. So does it matter? Here is also from Cochrane. Library? No. Regarding ventilator-associated pneumonia or mortality, in 16 studies, no difference. The same thing from critical care medicine, also meta-analysis. It's no difference in ventilator-associated pneumonia, or actually also in spreading of infection that also discussed this in recent study. But it may be different regarding oxygenation and de-recruitment. Some studies doesn't show anything, and other studies show something. And why is that? Could it be that the studies are not correctly done, or I think that you need to consider why you get de-recruitment when you suction a patient. And I think this is very important when you do different other studies, that you don't consider suction as a very important maneuver that can cause problem with the patients. So why do you get de-recruitment? Of course you get de-recruitment collapse from lung first by removing the positive airway pressure. And that will collapse the lung, and then second, to remove by the suction itself, that you can get the lung looking like a raisin. So why do you get the recruitment during closed suctioning? If you have the closed suctioning to keep the pressure in the lung at the same level that you as before, you need that volume that or the flow that goes down in the lung should be the same as the flow that is suctioned out. And that is dependent on that the suction catheter, of course. If it's very small, you cannot suction out so much. If the pressure is not much, you cannot suction out so much. But it's very important that you have a lumen beside beside this suction catheter in the endotracheal tube. Otherwise, it's impossible to get down there here. The same thing may be also depending on the type of ventilation you use. If you have volume-controlled ventilation, where very small tidal volumes, then the flow rate is not enough to compensate for the suction flow. If you have pressure-controlled, it usually the ventilator tries to keep up the pressure. Of course, you need to have that it's very easy for the ventilator to trigger. If you have the other hand, very large bore catheter, no volume will go out here, and maybe at the end actually you can suction down secretion from above the tube. So if you just look at this, so you need to consider the suction pressure catheter size and tube size and ventilator mode. If you see here in tube 6 size and catheter number 14, it's no area between the suction catheter and the tube. And of course, when you put in this in the patient, you just suction out and the lung will collapse, independent of if you use closed or open suction system. You can see here also, here is a impedance measurement, and actually you can see the lung volume decrease when the impedance decreases. And here is an animal model, neonatal model. Here you start the suction and the volume decreases and then goes slowly up here in 80 minutes back again. And you can see it here on the impedance images that A, B, and then suction, you have no volume at all, and then slowly it comes back again. And what you see here is the same thing. It's a tube ID4, it's a neonatal model, pressure 140, open, closed. If you have a small bore catheter, you can see that open system, you get the recruitment comes back, closed, no problem. But with large bore catheters, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if you're open or closed. And that I don't think is considered in all studies. So I can just say here that ET suctioning used in current clinical methods and catheter sizes causes significant loss of end-expiratory lung volume and tidal ventilation within all lung regions. Suction catheter size exerted a greater influence on lung volume and loss, lung volume loss than the suction method. But if you get the recruitment, you can just recruit the lung again. We showed that for some years ago, that here you suction the patient, and without any recruitment maneuver, oxygenation does not go back, but if you do it, oxygenation goes back the same with lung volume. With percut maneuver, lung volume goes back directly, but it takes time. Here in this study, it was not back again after 25 minutes after the suctioning. So my recommendation, suction only when secretions are present. Sometimes I think some patient really need to be there. You should not allow the nurses to do it. You should not lose low pressure. You should use thin catheters. And the recommendation respiratory care is that the external diameter of catheter should be divided by the internal diameter of the endotracheal tube should be less than 0.5. Pre-oxygenation can always discuss, as Professor Finnegan has shown, that oxygen will cause atelectasis, but I think that it's easy to recruit. If you need to do it, you can use it. Shallow suctioning, that is, use suction just below the tube, short duration, and maybe in severe ALDS patient, close suctioning if you're using thin catheters. If you don't using thin catheters, it doesn't matter what type you're using. And if you get a desaturation that probably is due to the recruitment, then you may use a recruit maneuver. Thank you.